Well, hi there. Welcome to Bett Studios, where we're conducting a mini series with some amazing startups that have been on their journey through Bett Futures. I'm Al Kingsley, CEO of NetSupport and all round EdTech fan. And I'm really pleased to have Adam in the studio. Hello there.
Hey, good to see you.
Great to have you here. Obviously, one of the people that I met at Bett last year was your good self and your solution, Sphinx AI. So cool. We wanted to get you in the studio and find out more about your journey.
Great.
So let's kick things off with a really simple one, which I know will be absolutely in your wheelhouse. Tell us about Sphinx AI.
Sure. Okay. So Sphinx AI is a kind of spin out from the school where I'm deputy head, which is Caterham School. And we build AI platforms specifically for education. And we've got two products, one out in the market and one just going into pilot at the moment. So the first product is called RileyBot, and it is, we think, the first AI chatbot designed specifically for schools. And what that means is when a school signs up to use RileyBot, they're getting a product that syncs with their MIS, which means that when the children log in, RileyBot knows how old they are and gives them age-appropriate responses. But it also has a kind of teacher persona, which is kind of the antithesis of what AI chatbots want to be. They want to give you the quickest route to the answer. Yeah. But with RileyBot, you know, you might say, can you write me an essay about photosynthesis? And RileyBot will say, no, but I will help you write your own essay. And I'll give you some structure and I'll give you some prompts and you can show me what you've written and I'll give you some feedback. And so the idea behind it is leveraging everything that is really powerful about generative AI, but putting it into a context where children can use it to get themselves unstuck rather than just go to the answer. So the big focus for us with that is around student efficacy. And that's kind of the impact that we're seeing at the moment.
I love that. There's so much talk about AI and some of the challenge is always not just what the potential is, but how does it actually fit and apply, particularly within the education context? And you know, the magic, the secret sauce is always that co-production. Yeah. It's actually using the technology, but making it pedagogy aligned, educator driven, putting those guardrails in place. Mm. And often we do challenge. We think about the role of AI as a great tool potentially for time saving in curriculum resources and lesson planning and content. When we move into the realms of using them within the learner space, people tend to get a bit more concerned about how do we do that in a constructive way that doesn't bypass the child's learning experience themselves.
Yeah.
So how do you find in terms of engagement how students respond to that?
Yeah, I think it takes a bit of time for students to understand what it is, because I think initially the kind of sense of it is it's a kind of Google replacement. And of course that's actually the kind of worst use case, because we know that generative AI can make mistakes in a way that maybe Google less so. Yeah. But I think once you help them understand that it is essentially like having your own personal teaching assistant, so you can just say, I'm stuck, help me, and get feedback in that ongoing way, it makes a lot of sense. And you see, you know, I've seen it with the children at Caterham that they are really able to get themselves out of a bind and move on with their learning. And I think, yeah, it's as you mentioned, sort of working with schools, being in a school, yeah, we recognized that safety was paramount. And so we have a teacher dashboard as well. So the teachers can see all of the conversations that students have.
Okay.
And anything that hits a kind of safeguarding threshold flags an alert, just as it would with any kind of web filtering product. And so the DSL or whoever that person is in your school can go in, see what got flagged, and decide whether they need to do anything about it.
And that really unlocks, because the natural barriers when it comes to any new technology, one clearly when it comes to AI is those guardrails.
Absolutely.
What content's available and how it's presented. There's the one that we all love, which is, you know, having to do our DPIAs and having transparency about what data is captured, where is it stored, and rightly so.
Of course.
But often that becomes more of a barrier than the opportunity to actually evaluate the potential of the tool. So, you know, I love the fact that you have that really explicitly signposted as the kind of foundation of what you're offering.
And I think, you know, you said transparency about where the data is. I think the level above that is the transparency of just letting the parents, because we have a parent dashboard as well, the parents and the teachers just see what's going on, so that AI becomes a bit less scary. Like if you don't work in that space, it feels quite complicated and a bit threatening. You only tend to hear quite negative things about, you know, you saw whole countries ban ChatGPT.
It's that nasty robot in a warehouse somewhere.
And I think by saying, here is a really simple interface and you can see every part of it, you can see exactly what your child is doing, that kind of removes the fear and just goes, yeah, I can see how that helps. And that really is the key to it, I think.
Fantastic. So we've talked lots about RileyBot and how that is absolutely evolving to be that student's personal teaching assistant, which is fantastic. Tell us about Chip.
Okay. So Chip is a totally different solution. It is rooted in a problem we had at Caterham long before there were safeguarding solutions around trying to keep good records about pupils and their journeys, you know, when they leave, when teachers leave, and it was all in emails and that sort of thing. So we built Chip as a kind of precursor to some of the more established solutions that are in the marketplace now. It was doing that kind of teacher observation, tracking of what was going on. And over the years, we've added in other elements like academic tracking, so we can compare pastoral observations with academic tracking. And as teachers left Caterham to progress with their careers, the one of the things they would come back and say is, yeah, we're using these other solutions, like, could we use Chip? And we had never really thought of it in those terms. But as the kind of AI explosion happened and we'd begun talking about how we might commercialize that platform, it just seemed the perfect marriage of, well, we've already got something which we're very proud of and does a good job. If we added intelligence into it, it actually sort of started doing some of the analytics about what is happening with pupils and cohorts of pupils and subsections of your community, that would be incredibly exciting. So that essentially is what we've developed.
So for listeners thinking, okay, now what box does this fit in? Would you categorize Chip as an assessment tracker or a behavior tracker or a pupil progress tracker, an MIS? Where does it fit? Because there's quite a Venn diagram.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Solutions. So it sits on top of your MIS, but beyond that, it's all of those other things that you said. It is pastoral, academic tracking. It's using AI so that you can ask questions of your own data. So as a senior leader, you can log into Chip and say, which group of kids should I be worried about?
And for those people flagging and saying, oh, AI again, this is very much non-generative, isn't it? In a sense, it's looking at what you've got and helping inform decisions.
Exactly, yeah. We have two machine learning engineers who are working with the data to help show it to schools in ways that is helpful. And I think that that's the other key bit, is just presenting data in a simple way that is easy to understand, but then you can also ask questions of. It's kind of like the golden goose, isn't it? We all want that, but we all struggle to find the time to generate that for our stuff.
That very much is the secret sauce, because for years now, we've had an accumulation of more and more data, courtesy of amazing tools and solutions, but we don't necessarily use that data with purpose. In fact, some of the data doesn't get used at all.
Indeed.
And I've always felt that the kind of the holy grail and the sweet spot of data is that it's sometimes it's less and more, but it's about how does it proactively inform decision making by the humans.
100%.
And charts and tables and graphs are great, but it's always about, are they with purpose?
Yeah.
So it's good to hear that that's the kind of the driver. So as a teacher, and I'm thinking, okay, well, I've got different tools that I use at the moment. Why Chip? What am I going to expect as a benefit?
Well, I think, firstly, it's the consolidation of tools. I mean, that was one of the big drivers for us, is we know, because we talk to lots of schools, that they have 3, 4, 5, 6 different platforms where they've got bits of data, and we are putting it all into one place. So the idea with Chip is you can look at a pupil dashboard, and that page should show you literally everything you know about that pupil, everything. And if it doesn't, we haven't got it right yet, but that is what we believe we're doing.
Fantastic. Again, it's about creating tools to meet a need from lived experience.
Exactly.
And that's a really important recipe and a driver. And obviously that comes through loud and clear from both your solutions. And I have no doubt there'll be other solutions as part of that framework that might come and build on what you've done. So we take that conversation forward. I met up with you not quite a year ago, but it was back in January, wasn't it, for Bett Futures. And you were showcasing that solution, talking about it. And obviously Bett Futures is an amazing launch pad. Sometimes it's not a launch in the sense of the first outing, but it's the next springboard, perhaps, is a better one as an accelerator. So tell us about your experience of taking the product and how that how that was presented, if you like, the Bett experience.
Well, for us, it was an absolute first outing. So we were, this was the first time we were sharing our platforms. And we I've been going to Bett as an educator for over a decade. So I know what it's about. And I have to say, you know, for however many years it's been in place, the kind of futures element to it has always been the bit that I look forward to going to the most, because that's where you see what's developing, what people are really trying to do to push the boundaries, who's that plucky upstart who's trying to do something different to the big guys who are well established and do what they do brilliantly, but these little challenges coming and go, well, maybe we can do it differently. So be able to be part of that community was very exciting.
It's good to root for the little guys.
For sure, absolutely. Isn't it? Well, I would certainly think so now.
the big organizations, you know, they absolutely are heavily involved in innovation.
Of course.
But it's not just the innovation. I think that the futures is also thinking about people who've got completely new spins on how technology can be infused to support learning in some shape or form. And it really feels to me, as somebody that gets involved, so the last year, that there's quite a lot of cross-pollination between the attendees there and their own experiences. How did you find it from your perspective?
Yeah, absolutely. I think, you know, because you've got your own little zone, you do get to sort of wander about and meet people and sort of get a sense of what people are trying to do. And that is really helpful. You get and just sort of that sense of community, because we're all in that same boat of, you know, we are the very smallest fish in a very, very big pond. And just that sense of community is quite reassuring.
It's a nice check and balance as well, and validation in terms of, you know, that heart of co-production. It's always really useful to get others who are on a similar journey to get a sense check of whether we're shaping down the right pathway, or we've missed an opportunity where maybe we might, our approach to market or our approach to development might change.
Yeah.
That's all part of that overall experience.
100%. And I think that the sort of showcase theatre that you oversaw our session of was really validating in that sense of we all, you know, I think four or five of us got to stand up and share our stories just in a few minutes, and you get to think, okay, yeah, I'm in a real, I'm doing this real thing with, absolutely, you know, other companies from, and they were from all over the world. It was incredibly inspiring to be.
It was actually fun as well, though.
Yeah, totally. Absolutely.
You know, the sense of I'm at Bett, and I get to go off on a stage and talk about my new solution can be quite an intimidating approach. But actually, it's such a collegiate atmosphere. Everyone's rooting for everybody to really showcase that it's nice when there's as many laughs and smiles as there is the kind of the sense of presentation.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So as you reflect back on Bett, how's that influenced and assisted in your journey since then? What have been the real takeaways for you?
I think undoubtedly the biggest benefit of being at Bett is, as a startup, is that you are able to test your concept, because you have got an enormous number of visitors who, firstly, you have to convince them to even stop by your stand because you're the little guy with the smallest stand going. And then you get to have a conversation and say, can I keep your attention long enough and show you that this is worth you stopping? And then you get feedback, and that is, I mean, you can pay to have better focus groups than the attendees at Bett. They are a discerning group who come from all sorts of different backgrounds who will tell you what they think. And that is, for us, we're very lucky. It was very affirming and really helped us think about which bits we had got right already and which bits we needed to work on and tell people we were going to improve in the future.
I think those are the really the core kind of value adds that you get from that environment. Obviously, you also start to get involved in that broader community of networking.
And then you kind of spend the next however many months sort of following up the leads, the people that you meet. I think reflecting on when the right time to follow up with different people. Oh, that was a really interesting learning experience. We had some great conversations with investors, for example, which is a tiny little startup you don't necessarily expect, but people treated us with real respect and interest in a way that I wasn't necessarily sure we would be able to achieve in our very first outing. And they were also generous with their time sort of during the show, but also afterwards. And even though it turned out at the beginning, it wasn't the right time to have those conversations, they, you know, so many of them sort of gave me pointers of where I could go next and when to come back to them. And that, you know, you don't know what you don't know, especially when you're a startup. So to have people willingly give up their time to sort of point you in the right direction was just wonderful.
I mean, you think connections, contacts, leads, potentially investors. Those are the things that fundamentally are the engine room that prime the pump for any business.
Yeah.
You know, and that combination of all of those is hugely powerful.
Yeah. And the fact that you get all of those in that really concentrated few days, you know, you could spend weeks and months trying to find those people and not quite ever make it to the phone call or whatever that you need. But they're all there with an open mind, wandering about, just looking for opportunities is incredible.
I totally agree. I think it's a fantastic accelerator, and it's great that your experience really reflects that. Thank you for sharing.
Yeah.
It's an opportunity to start to find different ways to articulate and engage with others about your solution.
Yeah.
And I think that's, you know, credit to yourselves. It's great to see the solution so rooted in those core values from an education perspective, and that Bett and the Futures Zone has been such a great sort of springboard to help you on your journey.
Yeah.
So when I sort of think that's a bit of future gazing, I'm sure there are other things. You've obviously already got your RileyBot that's out there and being used. You've got Chip running alongside to make teachers' lives easier and bring everything together. How do we see the next year, the next 5 years? What's the future plans and aspirations?
Yeah. So I wish I had that crystal ball, to be honest. But I guess, as a startup, the challenge number one is figuring out how to scale effectively and deciding if it's possible to find good partners to work with and just getting your story out there. Like, opportunities like this are fantastic, but it has to be an ongoing battle, because you are fighting against the established players, whether they're solutions people are happy with or not. That is the challenge with education, is those people who make decisions are super busy, because I've been one of those people.
Yeah.
And you have to make it worth their while to give up even 20, 30 minutes to have a call to even look at your solution.
It is difficult to make a noise in a very loud space.
Yeah.
I think one of the things that, you know, is something throughout my career and something that resonates me with Bett and how it's delivered, is it isn't about biggest equals best. Mm-hmm. It's about the opportunity to look at the evidence and the efficacy behind tools. And sometimes big solutions are the best, but sometimes there are new, fresh ways of approaching problems or tackling challenges. And right now, you know, biggest challenge in my trust, teacher recruitment, retention, SCMH, workload, all those things feed in, you know, and often it's about technology as a lever to save time and make sure that human-to-human interaction can occur.
Yeah.
And that's more important than thinking about has it shifted a lever on progress 8 or attainment. Not that we're going to have progress 8 for a couple of years.
Yeah.
Gonna...
But I really couldn't agree more with that. I think if your solution isn't grounded in the real lived experiences of teachers and students, why would anybody spend their very valuable time considering you as an option? I think that's what we have been able to achieve, is because we are from a school, we understand what schools feel like and what the pressures are, that's the value I think we add.
I think the catchphrase at the moment, which is not really a catchphrase in a flippant way, because it's a really important one, is evidence-informed EdTech.
Yes.
Whatever we've got, let's show the evidence behind it, the problem we're trying to address. And it's great to hear. So it's onwards and upwards.
Absolutely.
But in an ever-changing world, it's hard to predict too far. But I have no doubt we will see you in part of the Bett conversations in the years ahead, and look forward to the opportunities of talking to you again. Adam, thank you so much. I have no doubts listeners will want to find out more and connect with you. So how's the best way to engage and find out?
Yeah, if you want to connect with me, you can do that on LinkedIn, but you can also check out our website, which is sphinxai.education.
Fantastic. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks for tuning in to our conversation. And I certainly look forward to seeing you at Bett next year.
Thanks.